From hope to denial and acceptance, the families have been dealing with so many different emotions as they wait for any word. Joining me now to discuss this is Erik Fisher, psychologist here in Atlanta. Erik, so good to have you here and to get your perspective. Break it down for me, the range of emotions that these relatives are dealing with, what they're going through.
Well, I think what we've seen emerge is an element of mistrust. And I think there's a large element of mistrust in government, in industry, and the ways that they spin stories. So when you have mistrust, it's going to lead to fear. And then when you have fear and mistrust, there's helplessness, powerlessness, and they don't know what's happened with their loved ones. So this incredible sense of grief and sadness that they have to look at too. Now the other fact you're adding in, as this has dragged on for 14 days now, the exhaustion that they're feeling, because so many of them, as even some of the people that were interviewed were saying, they haven't slept. And how can you sleep when you think that someone you love is in peril and pain?
And that's something that we've heard from a number of these relatives. The fact that some of them are holding on to this hope that, that their relatives are still alive. I mean, how long can you stay in what some call a state of denial?
Well, you know, it's kind of like until you have absolute proof, you don't want to give up on the idea that someone you care for is
dead. Because it's like you're giving up on them,
right,
in fact.
And the guilt that comes with it. What if you find out they're alive or something could have been done and you gave up? That survivor's guilt that someone would experience from that of having given up hope is just unimaginable. So they probably have their inside, you know, we have our real, feel, and ideal selves. Mm-hmm. Our ideal is the one we show the world. The ideal self is saying, I want them to be alive. Part of their real self is saying, but I kind of hope we can get closure because this is so painful and I don't know I can live. Now, if they have been hijacked and taken somewhere, what those passengers may experience or may be experiencing would be a trauma that they'd have to heal once they came home too, which is what people don't want to imagine as well, mm-hmm. which is why sometimes imagining that they're not alive anymore might be easier for some.
Before we talk to this idea of closure and being mm-hmm. able to process, I want to talk about the cultural aspect mm-hmm. of all of this, specifically the way Asian cultures mm-hmm. deal with expressing their emotions. Talk to me about how that is feeding into what we're seeing.
Well, they're very kind of closed emotionally. They try to deal with logic and work with logic. And when grieving happens, the grief comes out. They express that grief very openly. But there are periods of time that they're supposed to grieve. They're almost rituals that they have that they experience in grief. So the difficulty is, when do I start grieving? When am I allowed to grieve? And if I grieve too early, am I going to look weak, or how am I going to be perceived? But the whole swell of emotion here is just overwhelming. So I don't say there's a right or wrong way how to do it. We feel and we express those feelings. The other issue I have culturally is that China has their one child rule. Mm-hmm. And you know, you have a child and you don't know if they've had other children that they had to give up or lost in other ways. So they've lost who they put their whole life into and their legacy towards, that child's gone now.
Yeah, an absolutely great point. One last question for you before I let you go. If these families get the sad news that they mm-hmm. have lost their loved ones, how do they begin to process that and begin a process of rebuilding their lives? And sadly, the reality is moving on.
What they have already is a community. They have a community that they all have something in common. When a group goes through a trauma that they have something in common, that's a moderating factor to healing, and that's very positive. But you want that community to be positive on how they deal mm-hmm. with things. You don't want people to turtle in and pull away, because you need to work these things through. You need to grieve your loss. There's a pattern that we go through grief that typically is about a year long or more pattern, mm-hmm. depending on the individual. But it moves through the point of acceptance, and so many people get caught in their grief and they don't move through because of their guilt or their anger, their hatred, their helplessness, and other emotions that affect them in their lives.
Erik Fisher, great insight, really valuable perspective, and we do appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Thank you.